Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 28th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. The first item on our agenda is for members of the committee to consider whether or not to agree to take agenda item 3 in private. Is the committee content to do that? Agreed. We are agreed. Thank you very much. And our principal agenda item this morning is consideration, or further consideration, I probably should say, of the Auditor General for Scotland Accounts Commission report on adult mental health. Can I welcome everybody to the meeting this morning? We're very pleased to see you. The committee's taking evidence today in a round table format, that will allow for a more freewheeling session where we will be drawing on the experience of people and those they represent as well, both in the room, which I'll come to shortly, and online. For those of you that are online, which is the majority of you, if you want to come in at any point, if you could put request to speak in the chat box, that would be very helpful. That would assist us in making sure that you are brought in when you want to. Can I also ask you to keep on at all times your audio and camera? Your audio will be operated through the Parliament, so we'll turn on your mic for live audio when it's a point at which you want to speak. What I want to begin by doing, which is customary for the roundtable format, is for people to perhaps introduce themselves. So we'll go around one by one, but we'll start with Joe Anderson, who is here with us in the committee room. Joe, do you want to tell us who you are and your organisation?
Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Joe Anderson. I'm the Director of Influence and Change at SAMH. SAMH is Scotland's mental health organisation. We deliver services across Scotland, and we're delighted to have been invited today. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Could I turn to those who are joining us remotely and begin maybe, Miriam, with you?
Hi, good morning. I'm Miriam. I'm Project Coordinator of International Women's Group. We are based in Glasgow, and we are providing counselling service to ethnic minorities. Thank you.
Thanks, Miriam. That's very helpful. I'll now turn to Paula to introduce herself. Paula Fraser.
Hi, I'm Paula Fraser, and I'm Acting Manager of Voices of Experience, or VOX, Scotland, and we're a members-led mental health collective advocacy organisation.
Thanks, Paula. Peter, do you want to introduce yourself next?
Morning, I'm Peter Kelly. I'm Director of the Poverty Alliance, which is the National Anti-Poverty Network in Scotland. Very pleased to be here.
Thanks, Peter. We're very pleased to have you here. And next, Dr. Shari McDade. Shari.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Shari McDade, and I'm the head of policy and public affairs for the Mental Health Foundation in Scotland. And the foundation. Sorry, just to introduce the organization, I'm with the Mental Health Foundation is a UK-wide organization with a dedicated presence in Scotland, and we focus on prevention of mental health problems.
Thank you very much indeed, Shari. I'm now going to turn to Simon. If you want to introduce yourself.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm Simon Porter from the Royal Edinburgh Hospital Patients Council, and we're a collective advocacy organisation, obviously in Edinburgh, and I'm mainly here in support of Paula and VOX. We're a VOX member.
Thanks very much indeed, Simon. And last but by no means least, Kirsten, do you want to introduce yourself to us?
Hi everyone, I'm Kirsten Urquhart. I'm the Chief Executive of Young Scots. We're actually a national youth charity supporting young people aged 11 to 26. We're a generalist youth support organisation, so don't have a particular specialism in mental health, but support young people on a wide range of issues, and delighted to be here today. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. We're very pleased that you are here. What we want to do is cover some of the ground that the Audit Scotland Accounts Commission reports covered. And as I mentioned earlier on, if you want to come in particular, if you put RTS or request to speak in your chat box, that would be very helpful. Don't feel as though you are obliged to answer every one of the questions that we put. If you've got a particular hankering to come in, then we'll obviously take you. But there may be some areas that you don't have a particularly strong view on. What I want to do first of all is really go to a fundamental question which has been posed in the report, which is what the experience of people is, what the challenges are that people face when they are trying to access mental health services. And I'm going to begin by inviting Joe perhaps to give us your take on that, and then I'll go to other members of the panel.
Thank you. So we were very welcoming of the report. We actually participated on a number of occasions, and we feel it makes some strong recommendations that we do hope that the Scottish Government will take forward. Accessing mental health services was a key feature of the report, unsurprisingly. And I think that, you know, from what we hear when we talk to people, which we do every day, that it's very challenging for individuals, often quite distressing for people who are seeking help for their mental health. Confusing pathways, constantly having to repeat what is a deeply distressing situation that you have to account each time you meet a new health professional. And then many messages about the length of time it might take to receive that support, or indeed that you might be deemed not unwell enough to receive that support. So there's a lot going on in terms of messages that people are receiving as they're trying to access. People tend to, and we test on this quite often, people tend to use their GP as the main gateway to accessing support. Obviously, the report highlighted that. The last time we tested this, I think about 75% of the population in Scotland said that would be the first place I would go if I was feeling mentally unwell. What we also know from the work that we did in that survey was that people wait quite a long time to even reach out to their GP, and their mental health is worsening constantly. So it takes a long time for people to get to that point of asking for help, and then they are experiencing confusing pathways, long waits for treatment. So even after they might access that support in some way, shape or form, again, that can be quite challenging. When the pandemic hit, we were most concerned about people who were already in receipt of mental health care and support and what that meant for them during the pandemic and in particular in the lockdowns. So we conducted some research with people who were in that situation. And 6 out of 10 of the participants, and we tracked their situation over the course of the pandemic, 6 out of 10 participants reported challenges seeking support from GPs and specialist services, lack of consistency in who was delivering that support, challenges with remote delivery, and long wait times to get to the specialist support. There was also a clear preference for face-to-face support among that population who already had some experience of mental health care and support. So there's a wide set of issues going on here around how difficult it can be for people when they've made the decision to seek help to then access it.
Thanks, Joe. I mean, the expression which the Auditor General used was slow and complicated. Do you think that sums it up quite well?
Yes, it does.
Thank you.
And I think there are some good examples where there are some there is progress being made, and maybe we'll come on to that in the discussion.
Yeah, absolutely. Graeme, did you want to come in at this point?
I did, yeah. And by the way, the other panellists, if you just put your hands up or whatever it is you need to do, doesn't all have to be Joe. But something that Joe said sort of struck me as, I think this affects everyone, it's not just people suffering mental health, is it? Getting to see a GP now is more difficult, probably more difficult than it ever has been. And if you have a mental health issue, and of course that, as you all know, covers a broad range of you know, there is a broad range of mental health issues. But your first step is to get past a receptionist who you might have to phone up in order to see a GP. And if it's anything like my GP, you'll have to describe your condition. And, you know, you might not want to. If you've got a mental health issue, you may just not want to tell somebody who's not a GP what that condition is. So I just wonder if people think that is putting people off even seeking help, let alone getting help. And I suppose the follow-up question to that would be, is the GP necessarily the best person to go to, or is there anywhere else you could go?
Okay, I'm going to ask Joe to answer that. Then I'm going to bring in Peter on this kind of general theme, and then other people might have a response to the GP gateway point which Graham has made. Joe, first of all.
I mean, you're absolutely right, Graham. There, as I was describing, the number of times you have to describe to somebody your situation, and the receptionist is the first place. People have been telling us quite often, particularly during and post-pandemic, that it is difficult to even get to sit in front of a GP. And quite often they feel that there are other more prominent health problems that perhaps they don't want to put a burden on an already overstretched system. So people face a reluctance. And I think that's a psychological thing, that perhaps their situation is not as important as others. So they de-escalate on that basis. On the point about our GPs, the only gateway to getting mental health support, it shouldn't be. And we think that community-based direct referral supports should be widely available, and have been calling for those kind of supports for some time.
Thanks. I'm going to bring Peter Kelly in, and after Peter I'll bring in Dr. Shari McDade. But Peter, I'm going to turn to you next.
Thanks. Yeah, as kind of to pick up on some of the points that Joe's just made. In preparation for this session, we did a snapshot survey with Poverty Alliance members. We had around 60 responders on general issues around accessing adult mental health services. One of the things that struck us from the responses that we had was the increase in more focused approaches from community-based third sector organisations. So we asked what the change in the representation of mental health issues for those organisations had been since before the pandemic to now. And around about 15% were always dealing with mental health issues. So when individuals using their services presented, there was always a component of mental health in the reason for the presentation. Now seeing that 40% of those organisations see people presenting with mental health issues every time. So the organisations we're working with have seen a significant increase in the representation of mental health issues. And these are some of them are specialist organisations working on mental health specifically. Many of them are not. Many of them are food banks, advice organisations. And they're having to scale up, if you like, in order to deal with the change in nature of the issues that people present with. But in terms of the challenges that people face in accessing services, they are similar to what Joe has mentioned. So the importance of GPs, I think almost all of the respondents talked about the importance of GPs being the initial gateway into receiving help, and I think there are very well-known problems with accessing GP services, and then the issue of what happens to the onward referral to specialist services where those are made, not always receiving a service once a referral is made, was one of the issues that was mentioned. I think the additional question is some of the practical dimensions of accessing services. So we had a number of organisations based in rural parts of Scotland where the very real problems of accessible transport to allow people to actually engage services was a very real one, and that was something that actually acted as a barrier to people receiving the help that they need. There's much more I can say on the role of the third sector, but I know that we'll pick that up later on, so I'll leave it there just now.
Thanks, Peter. We will, and we will also focus on the unequal impact of these health issues as well. Dr. McDade, I'm going to come to you. Then after that, I'm going to bring in Kirsten from Young Scott. But Shari, first of all, to you.
Thank you. And just to acknowledge that we're in the foundation very happy to be partnering with the Poverty Alliance on a program to build the capacity of their member organizations to be able to support people's mental health. That program is just in its early stages, and it's funded by the Scottish government. So to acknowledge that. And I think that links very much with what we hear in terms of where the gaps are in support. So I want to highlight particularly two at-risk groups that maybe haven't been raised so far, though others may come in on these perspectives as well, and appreciate that. And I'm drawing on our concerns around Black and minoritized ethnic communities from a roundtable that we held with organizations representing those communities when we prepared our submission to the mental health strategy, and also on our experience in hearing from the Diverse Experiences Advisory Panel, which is an advisory panel that's been set up in order to inform the Scottish government on its mental health policy, and which the Mental Health Foundation provides the secretariat for the Diverse Experience Advisory Panel. From both groups, we heard very much that for people in minority ethnic communities, that there are concerns around them, individuals there knowing how to access services. So there's significant problems with trying to, you know where to go for help and how to navigate the system, but also that when they do come in contact with the system, often they're met with a very white ethnocentric service that doesn't properly recognize the way that their community talks about mental health, understands mental health, and how it's appropriate within that community to try and respond. So that is something that, while it's mentioned in the mental health strategy and the delivery plan that was just published earlier this week mentions culturally sensitive services, but we can't see any specific action in the delivery plan that is there to deliver culturally sensitive mental health services, and that's a significant concern. Another group that we are working with is lone parents. And lone parents are a very high-risk group for a number of reasons. One is that they experience isolation just from the process of being a lone parent. But also, they're much more likely to be living in poverty. They're at higher risk of having low income. So what we have heard from, and I connected with my colleague who's running our program called Small Talk, which is working with lone parent organizations, is that while we have a perinatal mental health service, it's a specialist mental health services, and it's basically orientated towards providing crisis service for individuals or service for lone parents who are in have severe mental health problems. But we don't have provision for new lone parents for mild and moderate mental health problems. And that's a huge gap. And I think that really needs urgent attention.
Thank you. That's very helpful. And I am going to bring Miriam in next, but I'm going to next, I think, because I'm sure you will pick up some of those themes, and then I'll come back and bring in Kirsten. Miriam.
Thank you. Because she mentioned ethnic minorities, as I'm working with women ethnic minorities. So the Scottish government has acknowledged the existence of mental health inequality amongst ethnic minorities. This disparities of primary attitudes to lack of culturally appropriate service. So, and also the language barrier there is language barrier for ethnic minorities to access the mental health service. International Women's Group has been providing the service, counseling service to ethnic minorities women since 2014, but we weren't able to manage to provide this service to all of them. So we faced like a big challenge of waiting list as well because of that. And during the pandemic, we started to provide this service through the WhatsApp contact, which is video contact, and was like Arabic and English. So the culturally sensitive and multilingual service should be provided within the NHS service and the reduced waiting list, which caused like worse in the situation within the women, ethnic minorities. So I wanted just to add this, the cultural service and multilingual to the service.
Thank you very much. Miriam, are you saying that multilingual information is available or that there is a gap there?
It is a gap. It's not provided. So because of that, we had to take this action and start providing the service within the ethnic minorities. It's not existing. So they provide interpreters, which we found that women, we weren't comfortable to speak to two people, like interpreters and the counselor. So they prefer to find like the language they are looking for to speak face-to-face to the counselor.
Thank you. One of the themes that's highlighted in the report is the alarming rise in mental health issues for young people. And that's why we were particularly keen to get young Scott to give evidence to us this morning. So I'm going to turn to Kirsten to give us your perspective and the perspective of young people about at this stage about accessing the service and the challenges that young people especially have been facing with it.
Yeah, thank you. So we actually, together with some other youth organisations, kind of towards the end of last year, carried out some research with young people around, particularly around mental health and emotional wellbeing. So we had about well over 1,000 young people participate, all the way from age 8 up to 25 actually, but we did some kind of survey insight with that kind of older demographic, kind of 12 to 25, of which about 35% were 18 plus, and almost half of those that participated reported that they did not feel good about their mental health and well-being. So just like you were saying, it is an issue that young people are kind of dealing with. I think, though, what's interesting is some of the insight we had really kind of echoes what Joe had said about kind of access to services. GPs tend to be somewhere where the young people automatically think about going to as a kind of first port of call. But actually, there's kind of wider issues there. I think what young people are talking about is that kind of privacy, trust and confidentiality for them in terms of how they might access kind of services, and some of the issues and barriers that Peter picked up in terms of actually kind of physically being able to access services, transport, affordability, timing about when services are available for young people to access, have all come up as kind of issues for kind of young people. I think a big part of that as well is young people's kind of confidence in being able to know about where to access and how to access kind of services as well. So it seems like there's young people generally, they told us that over about half said that they felt that they could find information about mental health should they need it, but they felt less confident that it's actually they're given the correct information that they need. And there was also some things that came up there about school, this idea of accessing support in school and education kind of settings, that actually they're concerned about the kind of stigma that could be raised within a school environment in terms of, it might be if you want to engage with a counsellor, you're missing a lesson. And so there's a kind of stigma that arises potentially around, there are other learners about what they're seeking support for. So I think there's a wide range of issues. Face-to-face continues again, like Joe was saying, face-to-face is young people's preference in terms of accessing support. Digital is an important tool, but they look for the same characteristics of a kind of online digital support. So that kind of trust, not being judged, that privacy and feeling of safety, I think, is a big part of that. I think also we may come on to talk about digital services, but there is a big misconception that because young people spend a bit more of their time online, that young people are able to then use these services, these digital spaces, to access appropriate support. But actually going on TikTok is not the same as using, some kind of mental health support tool and knowing where to find it. So I think there's some big misconceptions, particularly of young people's ability to navigate digital tools. And it seems like a bit of a catch-all solution for supporting young people, when actually we are hearing that face-to-face, trusted individuals, trusted adults, and that kind of familiar setting and space is how young people want to access. And what we're hearing is that they possibly don't feel that confident at the moment to access those services. So very similar themes that we're hearing from children and young people that are still being reflected in this adult space as well.
Thanks, Kirsten. That's very helpful, and it's good to dispel some of the mythology about where digital exclusion lies. We've got a whole load of other areas of questions that we want to put to you, so I'm going to turn now to Sharon Dowie, who's the deputy convener, to put some questions about where the demand is and what the response from the services are to that. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Could I ask you a bit more about the current demand for mental health services, including where this demand is being felt the most among service providers, and also how unmet need is being measured? So I don't know who wants to come in on that one first. Have you got Andrew for online?
Paula, I don't know, do you want to come in on that question? And I apologise, I know you wanted to come in on the previous passage of discussion that we had, so please reflect on that, and if you've got any response to Sharon's question, then please answer that as well, if you can.
Okay, I'll just start with the previous bit first, if that's okay. Just to kind of echo what Joe was saying, Vox members took part in Audit Scotland's audit, and we really also endorse the recommendations that they've put in that report. And so a lot of the themes that were coming up from that are about access to services, unsurprisingly, and that's actually been our top priority of our members for a number of years, unfortunately, is the difficulty that they have in accessing services. And obviously part of that is the long waiting list, but also what was mentioned as well about the communication around how long a wait's going to be, or when you're going to get an appointment, or how you're going to get an appointment, and the fact that people maybe will have a phone call, and if they miss the phone call, that's them off the waiting list. Or if they miss an appointment, when they finally get an appointment, if it's a phone call rather than a face-to-face and they miss that phone call, people are saying that they're absolutely terrified. That's them not going to have any access to that service anymore. And that's what the experience of our members have been. And they've reported that that's gotten worse since COVID. And then just around also what Joe had mentioned about eligibility and this kind of idea of capacity. So a lot of our members will report this idea of being told that either they don't qualify and are not eligible to have any support or service that they wanted access to because they're too well, they're coping too well, they're too able, they're able to do this, or they're able to do that, or they're not crying, or they're not too upset, this sort of thing. And so that they don't actually need access to the service, they're being told, or they have a few appointments, for example, with a CPN, and then after those few appointments, they're told, well, you're doing fine now, you don't need this support. And of course, our members report that, they understand that probably this is to do with a lack of resource and lack of, enough workforce to be able to meet the demand, the increasing demand. But obviously for the person involved, that means that they're back to square one, they don't have the support they need, and they feel that then there's nothing to help them maintain wellness. And then it ends up with them in a crisis situation again. And this just repeats and repeats, and obviously costs a lot more money than just having those three monthly, for example, appointments with their CPN or whoever it happens to be. So that's one of the main things that our members continue to report. And just on the kind of face-to-face part as well, our members are talking all the time about that lack of choice. So it's sort of written maybe on their appointment sheet or whatever it is, that they have the choice of having face-to-face or choosing virtual appointments. And of course, for some members, that might be preferable. Maybe they would prefer that or it helps them to have a virtual appointment. But for a lot of them, they would prefer face-to-face and they're maybe not actually getting that choice and they don't feel that they have got agency and choice in the treatment that they're receiving. And like Kirsten was mentioning, that face-to-face thing is so important for building up trust, especially when it's a mental health issue that people are talking about. And it's very difficult for them to do that necessarily online. And it's also difficult for the clinician to pick up so well on what's going on with the person and be able to help them in that way. So that was another thing that was really important. And just on the kind of transport and accessing services in terms of transport, a lot of our members in rural areas are reporting that it's extremely difficult to get an appointment because there's no staff in their area to give them a psychiatry appointment or a CPN appointment, for example, or psychologist, and that they are willing to travel, but then it's very difficult for them to actually afford that travel, and arrangements are not put in place for them to be able to have that transport so that they can actually attend appointments that they would like to attend elsewhere. And I was just going to say, in terms of the GP question earlier, a lot of our members are reporting this same situation where it feels like the receptionist is the gatekeeper and that you have to get past them and prove why you need an appointment. And of course, that's very difficult to do and a bit humiliating, really, to have to talk about that with a receptionist. And so we do hear about that a lot as well. Going on to the other question about unmet need. I mean, obviously our members are in a variety of situations, and so they're reporting not being able to access services in terms of we're hearing people having to wait in A&E and that there's not an inpatient mental health bed for them to go to. We've been hearing that. So that's one of the situations where there's demand on services. But we're also hearing from our members that there are a two-year waiting list, for example, for them to see a psychologist if they're wanting psychological therapy. And that there are the waits, particularly in rural areas, but also in other areas, for them to be able to see a psychiatrist. And like I say, this kind of ongoing situation with people feeling that they do need a community psychiatric nurse, but there not being the facility there for them to have that continue and that they maybe only have a few sessions and then told that they're well enough to cope without it unless it's an extremely serious mental health problem that they've got, where they may have access to a CPN continuing if they've got a depot that they need to have. I hope that answers the question. Sorry for going on.
No, that's great. Thank you. If I could ask Jo Anderson.
Three things to say under the demand piece. So, I mean, demand, so the indicators are all, there's quite a lot of data that tells us that demand is rising. Obviously, the Audit Scotland report kind of highlighted some of those. So the calls to the NHS 24 mental health hub has increased dramatically over the last period. It's the same for our own mental health information service. We're expecting to speak to around 7,000 people this year, which is almost double what we were doing pre-pandemic. So people are reaching out to get information and support and signposting, and the numbers are there. The Centre for Mental Health also did a report during the pandemic that suggested that the NHS will need to 2 to 3 times its current capacity to adequately meet and treat the expected increase in mental health problems resulting from the pandemic. Now, that was an England and Wales report, but one can expect something similar for Scotland. So all the indicators and the dashboard is flashing, demand is increasing, and you can see that in the numbers of people being referred to psychological therapies, for example. And of course, the pandemic brought mental health and wellbeing into sharp focus for all of us. And I was just talking to the gentleman outside the room about that as we were coming in. So people are thinking about it more, and people are thinking about their wellness or not. And therefore, one can imagine that that will just, increase help seeking over time. And quite frankly, you know, people should be able to just ask once and get help fast. It's as simple as that. However, demand is on the increase. We know there are some groups that we should be concerned for because the mental health tracker that was run through Scotland during COVID was telling us that, and some of colleagues on the screen were describing some of those groups that whose mental health and well-being particularly suffered during the pandemic. So young people, as Kirsten was mentioning, and women, as others were mentioning, who and people with pre-existing mental health problems should all be groups that we have concern for and we should be targeting support to. And in terms of unmet need, because people aren't able to get the support through the traditional routes, unmet need will displace itself to other places, like workplaces and schools and community groups and sports groups and all the other places that we live our lives. And so therefore we expect that workplaces and other places are going to be needing to do a lot more on mental health and well-being in the future because people aren't able to access the support through health services.
Can I just go back to your previous comments earlier? You'd said about confusing pathways. You said about GP being the main gateway, and just in your response there, you'd said about asking once and getting help fast. Do you think that we've got a robust enough system so that people know the pathways that they can go on? And what I'm saying is there's various funding out there for different groups. See, once a group gets funding to help with mental health, are the GPs made aware of it? So are the GPs made aware of all the help that's been funded by Scottish Government so that they can then give that pathway quite clearly. So, and even first Miriam is the coordinator for the International Women's Group as well. So again, if a doctor was struggling to, for somebody from an ethnic minority, for a translator or to help them, would they know to go to that group to help? Or
I suspect the answer is no. Many years ago, there was an attempt to gather up all this intelligence, and I can't quite remember the name of the system, but it was being populated by lots of these programmes and supports and interventions to make it available to GPs so that they would be more knowledgeable about what was going on in their area. And sadly, it gets very tired very quickly because... Mm-hmm. Funding cycles mean that things go as quickly as they are set up. So it's a real challenge. What I would say, and when we were talking earlier about primary care and that kind of gatekeeping, one of the things that we think has been a particularly positive introduction is community link workers in primary care. So a dedicated team. We have a SAMH worker in every single GP practice in Aberdeen City. And we are there as a support system for individuals where mental health may be a component of the reason why they're sat in their GP surgery, but it may be other things too. And the GP can send them down the corridor to us. We've got the time to listen, to work out what would be the best supports for that individual, to support them to reach those community assets. It's a great program. But we've got great concern about the future of that programme because the emergency budget cut the £38 million to the mental health budget. And as a result, there was a delay to the mental health and wellbeing primary care services progression, which we think is of deep concern.
I would ask you more on that, but I think there's questions later on in funding, so I think we'll come back to it. Could I maybe bring in Dr...
Simon, I think, is next.
Simon's next, sorry. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. I think our members would see a mismatch between the supply and the demand, and that essentially you're spending money on the old paradigm, not the new convention with the rights of persons with disability paradigm. So I think our members might think you're spending too much on the biomedical model, the psychological stuff, not enough on the social side of the sort of what works for mental health. And I think maybe learning the Mental Health Foundation would call it task shifting. That I think what we hear is that a lot of people don't necessarily think mental health is a problem with them. It has a wider significance, and it might be worth spending money, more money on stuff that supports families, stuff that supports communities. I think Peter Kelly mentioned sort of community-based solutions. Instead of, I think what you might be doing is empowering professional groups very well. The psychiatry and psychology are very well empowered, but I don't know if you are empowering people to mutual aid and support their own mental health. So I think a paradigm shift towards much more sort of social funding might be what our members would like to see.
Thank you.
Well, I'll go on to your next question, I think, Sharon.
Okay, I'll just go into another question just now. If I could ask now about the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic and the cost of living crisis on demand for mental health services and how this is affecting service delivery. And if I could ask Dr. Shari McDade to come in on that.
Thank you. And I just wanted to follow up with what Simon Porter was saying around this idea of task. We call it task sharing. We are running a project in Dundee that is bringing together a variety of agencies with NHS CAM services to and schools and all the agencies and community supports that are working with children in order to try to get faster support for children that are on waiting lists in CAMs, but faster, a more appropriate support where many of the children may not need CAMs. It might be just as Simon was talking about, that it's a lot of other circumstances in a family situation that are giving rise to children having perhaps a behavioral issue that then needs some type of support. So very supportive of the idea of looking better at the resources in the community and how we can invest in communities, but also how we can bring those resources together. And also would really agree with Simon that oftentimes what we see and what people tell us that helps them in their mental health journey is, for example, peer support, is spending time and being given the opportunities to connect with other people in a similar situation. That's what we're working on very much with our Lone Parents project, Small Talk. It's very much around bringing lone parents together. And often young lone parents who say that they don't feel they comfortable going into even the regular new mother groups that may not have so many young mothers in them. And then we also are supporting that kind of work with the Alliance for Health Conditions in terms of, again, advising them on how they can bring people with long-term health conditions together to support each other. It's not a replacement for clinical services. It's not meant to be a replacement for very important clinical services that people need. But so much of the levels of mental distress that are around, the vast quantity of it is in mild to moderate mental health difficulties. And for those kinds of situations, it is possible that peer support can play a very important role. With regard to your question around the pandemic and the cost of living crisis, of course, our pandemic study, and I won't at the top of my head be able to quote exact statistics, so apologies for that, but I can get further information to you. But in terms of the pandemic, certainly our pandemic study showed a rise in levels of distress during the period of the pandemic. And what we saw then towards the end of the pandemic was that those levels of distress had not come down to pre-pandemic levels. And I think that's probably reflected in the kinds of statistics that SAMH was reporting around levels of demand for services. And we have done a bit of polling of the population around their the cost of living crisis. And when we've asked people about that, we found that people are reporting that the increasing cost of living is negatively affecting their mental health. And that doesn't surprise us because we know that financial stress is a very clear risk factor. It's a very clear risk factor for poor mental health. And if I just can say one thing about young people that I wanted to draw in relation to young people, from our study, our huge sample studies of young people in universities and young people in colleges, there was a quite clear link between lower levels of mental well-being among the students and food insecurity. And we often don't think about that, or maybe it's not spoken up enough about young people. There are lots of things in young people's lives that might be negatively affecting their mental health, but we often forget that the reality is that many young people today are struggling to have enough money to put to eat and to have adequate shelter. And that financial stress is going to be further exacerbating young people's mental health.
Thanks for that. Lots of points to consider. Could I ask Peter Kelly to come in now?
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's well understood that poverty is both a cause of mental health problems and a consequence. So I think at a time of acute financial crisis, really, that we've been through since the start of the pandemic, where we know that people who are already on low incomes suffered most during the pandemic, and then moving into the period of the cost of living crisis, which we're still very much in, we shouldn't be surprised that that translates into increased demand across a whole range of services related to mental health. I suppose a couple of areas or a couple of points just to make in that context. We did some research within the Scottish Women's Budget Group into women's experience of the cost of living crisis, and one of the very clear messages coming out of that was the mental health impacts of for women in particular having to manage poverty, as that report said, of being very much responsible for often being responsible for care within a family and trying to juggle that at a time of acute financial crisis. The other related issue, I think, is debt. So we have seen increasing levels of debt. One of the Poverty Alliance members who responded to our survey noted that from the period between 2018 to now, a third of their clients, debt advice agency, a third of their clients were reporting suicidal ideation when they presented. Now half of their clients are reporting suicidal ideation. I think that one statistic from that one organisation is really quite compelling about the impact that our current context is having on individuals' mental health. The other part of your question was around what happens to that demand. And I think as Simon and Shari and others have said, the importance of voluntary sector, community organisations in providing alternatives to primary care to address mental health issues early is really important. And I know we will talk about funding. Those services are very much under stress. But what our members told us their response to this current context has been, they've done various things. So around about almost 70% had increased training to staff and volunteers around mental health. Very often that was around mental health first aid. But looking to, as I said earlier, to skill up their staff and their volunteers to be better able to support the people that they're working with. Around about a fifth had recruited specialist staff who were providing specialist services to enable them to better able respond to these areas. But I think this is the tip of the iceberg, and really organisations are undoubtedly struggling to respond to the demand that's there. And I know, as I say, we'll go on to talk about funding issues later.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much, Peter, for that and the other contributors. I have to say, unfortunately, due to time limitations, we clearly aren't going to be able to take everybody who wants to come in on every question. So I shall try and exercise some egalitarian principles and make sure that everybody gets a reasonably equal amount of time. But, so apologies to those that wanted to come in on that question. But I'm going to move things along and invite Colin Beattie to put some questions to you.
Thank you, Mayor. I've got one or two subjects and covering the theme initiatives to increase in-person and remote access to support. Obviously, there's been initiatives across Scotland to increase in-person and remote access. NHS 24-111 Mental Health Hub, Distress Brief Intervention Programme are perhaps two of the main ones. What I'd be interested in asking is, there seems to be a wide variability in terms of primary care for mental health services. Third sector services, peer support services, the joining up is not perhaps what you would want to see. It could be better. And I'd be interested in the witnesses' feelings on that, their views on that. And Joe, maybe we can start with you since you're here.
Okay, thank you. So a few things to say. I mean, it's true that there is, you know, there are some great interventions and supports out there, and the system doesn't necessarily connect up so that people know how to get to these or how to refer on to these. And that would be a welcome improvement, that if we could make that in the system, I think that would help a lot of people. But it also comes down to the funding cycles that exist, I'm sure we'll come on to talk about later, but how these supports are literally on annuals funding cycles, and it's very difficult, particularly in the third sector, to plan over time for setting up something that is robust enough to exist beyond the end of a year. So it's that's a real challenge for us. On the DBI point that you mentioned, I mean, DBI is, I think it would be our view, quite a success story in Scotland. It is particularly effective in de-escalating distress for many thousands of people since its inception. We are one of the delivery partners, and we deliver it across multiple locations in Scotland. And it was extended to include young people, which again, I think was a real benefit of the programme expanding to recognise that there were lots of people that would benefit from such a service. But we know that the dedicated funding for that is going, and that there will then be, you know, it will be down to local commissioning and procurement processes to determine the future kind of DBI provision. Thankfully, the national pathway remains in receipt of dedicated funding until March 26, which is good news, which means anybody coming through the 111 number will still be able to get into the DBI service. But we have concerns about what might happen in local commissioning on such a service, and we absolutely believe that we should retain the core elements of the service as it was set up. And our slight fear is that we might end up with DBI-lite versions or drawing it in with other services and commissioned jointly. And we think that might be, that should be a concern for all of us.
I suppose when we're talking about variability, we're talking about availability of the service and the quality of the service, some of which comes back to funding, I guess.
Yeah.
Can I bring Paula Fraser in?
Hi. Yeah, our members, most of our members have severe and enduring mental illnesses, and they've reported that, you know, for example, phoning NHS 111 is not actually going to be helpful for them in getting the help that they need. It seems to be more of a kind of having a talk through and then a signposting kind of service, and then they're signposted on to something that maybe isn't actually available or that they can't get access to. And in terms of the variability, I think we hear about that a lot. Like's been mentioned before, about peer support and about community link workers and how valuable those services are, and wellbeing hubs and that sort of thing, they're completely varied across the country, and whether you can have access to them or whether you can take part and attend a local wellbeing hub or have peer support is something that just seems to vary from place to place, and it's something that our members are continually asking for and wanting. And obviously you've seen in the Scott review that was one of the recommendations about the wellbeing hubs and people having access to that and the peer support. So I do think that's an issue. And I think maybe had been mentioned in the report, the Audit Scotland report was about how it's not necessarily always, obviously there will be specialist clinical support needed for people at times, but it's not necessarily always about the kind of high level of specialist training that somebody has, but actually about the attitude and the time that they take for somebody. So actually being empathetic and being able to listen. So some of our members have reported that, you know, they've got a brilliant GP who does still have the time to be able to talk to them, and they have those regular appointments, and that's what keeps them well. Or it might be that it's a community link worker, or it might be that it's a peer support worker, but it's not necessarily about always about seeing a psychiatrist or a psychologist, but it's about that maintaining a kind of trusted, empathetic attitude from somebody who they're able to connect with. And that's not available for everyone across the country when they need it. And in terms of crisis support, people are saying crisis support is something that you really, really need at the weekends and during the night, and that's something that they're not being able to get access to when they need it, and our members report that continually, and that seems to have gotten worse again through the COVID pandemic and afterwards.
Thank you. Maybe I can bring Kirsty Urquhart in.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose I don't have a huge amount of insight, particularly from young people, in relation to kind of crisis support. I think just to add to some of the points that Paula were just making about kind of timing of access to services, it is something that young people have flagged with us, that quite through the survey work we've done, that actually those services are sometimes during business hours when they're at school or in employment, but also for potentially kind of younger people, and accessing some digital support. You know, quite often they don't have access to devices. You know, if they're living with a parent or carer, they might not restrict their access at certain times of the day when they need it most. And so there's a whole range of issues that might impact young people being able to access those services. I think, again, we've mentioned things like kind of transport and accessibility. I think some of the work that we do, I mean, you'll be aware of things like the Under 22 Free Bus Transport Initiative that we work in partnership with. And it's about thinking about, you know, transport is always a barrier to accessing services. And it's something that young people in particular have issues with accessing. And so there's initiatives that we look to do and to work in partnership with to make sure that it's not just about the particular kind of mental health challenge, but it's the looking at the bigger picture, the world of a young person, and what are the things that make accessing kind of services and support possible. I think going back to just some of the points that were made earlier about access as well, that, you know, some of this is about, it's not always about that acute crisis access. We're seeing, you know, that kind of post-COVID cost of living crisis, and we're hearing from young people about, you know, that kind of secondary mental health. They're witnessing their parents and carers going through really challenging times, and that's having access. You know, we've got a stat from a survey that we did in December, over 70% of young people are concerned about the financial pressures on their parents, carers, and the associated stress and impact on their mental and physical health. We've got young people, we talk about, you know, that kind of triggering aspect, that with a 16-year-old saying that they're worried because they're embarrassed about not having enough money for lunch, they're worried about their parents not being able to put food on the table, young people saying that they don't want to go and continue their studies because they want to go out and work to contribute towards a household and things. So this kind of secondary impact on young people is really kind of heavily felt. I think also to add to that, just quickly, that, you know, during COVID, lots of services closed for young people. Cost of living crisis, we're seeing swimming pools, leisure centres, all of these things that should support young people to live their lives and have fun and do the things that they should be able to do, that support their emotional, physical well-being and mental health, and that the access to that is being decimated across communities across Scotland. And I think it is something we have to pay attention to. What are the things, the preventative measures that we're putting in place to support young people? Well, not just young people, everybody's well-being. And I think that it's a whole system approach that we have to look at supporting young people's mental health. So thanks.
Thank you. Just to move on to a slightly different aspect, what are the advantages and disadvantages of in-person versus remote access for support? And to what extent do people have a choice in the type of support that they receive? I'll ask Simon Porter to come in on that.
Well, thanks, yeah, because I was going to quickly say about the intersectoral partnership working that I'd understood the other question, but because I think the advocacy view on this is that there is a power dynamic between sort of the NHS and IJBs and local authorities, and a kind of a pecking order. So I suppose these are the reasons that we see as sitting in the sidelines about partnership working between third sector and public sector. There's a sort of an assumption, a pecking order, that the NHS, you know, the professional, that's the serious, safe, good stuff, and, you know, and social care is kind of like the keen amateurs, and, you know, mean well-intentioned, but we don't really know what we're doing. So we do see there's sort of an epistemic injustice aspect of an undervaluing of social care in your funding. And I guess wondering if the National Care Service could help equalise that, because I think the NHS, in a way, it's disproportionately powerful. And it sucks. It's like it exerts a gravitational pull of resource and attention that I don't think the patients think it warrants. I missed your question there about do people have choice? Well, no. There's coercion. The system, the mental health system, our end of it, relies on coercion, which is a human rights violation. So obviously, by definition, there most or many people in the psychiatric hospitals do not have a choice to be there and do not have a choice about the treatment they are receiving. And their voice is basically irrelevant. What they want matters very, well, not really, it doesn't really matter at all. So yes, there is no choice in this system for many of its most disabled users.
Thank you. Maybe I could ask Miriam to comment on the advantages and disadvantages of in-person and remote access.
Oh, hi, yeah. There is the disadvantages in accessing. So as I mentioned, is language barrier as well is an issue, and ethnic minorities, women. So they don't have any information who to approach, as we mentioned earlier. Like the only way they think to contact is their GP, so they don't have more information who to contact in that issue. Also, as I mentioned earlier, like they don't feel comfortable to use interpreters. They prefer to speak like directly about their issues to the counselor. Also, disadvantages for as a community group, we don't have enough resources to provide all their needs. Like we are very limited in resources, so it's just few hours, and we have a quite a big list at waiting list as well to see all this needed women need the service. So this is some of disadvantages. Although IWG is trying to provide other activities for women to ease like isolation. For example, we provide yoga and Zumba exercise, so to bring them in and try to reduce in that way some mental health issues. This is some advantages that we are able to provide to with our limited resources. Also, like we provide English classes while they are waiting for the college places. So they are ethnic minorities. Their language is not English, so we have to take this in in consideration. So we provide English class, so they learn English, which we can like come to address some language barrier. Also, we provide like drop-in to come in and meet other and talk. And so we are providing some of advantages that we were able to secure some fund to reduce some mental health issue, thinking about cost of living. So we provided some vouchers to women, to families, like to reduce some like mental health in like thinking a lot about their financial issue, and this where we are able to provide. Thank you. Hopefully I answered the question.
Perhaps one last person I would ask is Dr. Shari McDade on this question.
Yes, well, I mean, I think Simon has raised the very important point about it being a person's choice. So while the evidence that I am aware of from a few years ago about the effectiveness of online versus in-person usually shows that they're about equivalent. In fact, in that what we see around effectiveness is that online effectiveness isn't really less than in person. However, that very much depends on, as Paula was pointing out, the quality of the relationship that's able to be built between the therapist and the individual seeking help. And we know that all the evidence is that the quality of that relationship is key to whether you get any therapeutic benefit. And so I think it is quite important that the digital option is the person's choice. On the other hand, I think I have seen evidence that that having that choice means that people who may never have come forward for mental health support previously do come forward for that support. And again, even if we think about parents of young children, I've heard that, you know, for parents of young children, the fact that they don't have to try to organize with their infant to get out the door to be able to get support, but that they could actually have that support from their home might be the difference between them being able to get help and not get help. For people who have still a high sense of stigma around seeking help, we think that perhaps, for example, for men or older people where there's, you know, still some levels of stigma around seeking help for mental health, that having the digital option could be really important for enabling people to access support that they otherwise might not go near.
Thank you. Just for my last question or subject, we've already talked a little bit about NHS 24/111 mental health hub and the Distress Brief Intervention Programme. So we've heard some feedback on that. But what's the impact on that, on these programmes, of the withdrawal of dedicated funding for these initiatives? And maybe I can ask Peter Kelly to comment.
I have to say that's not an area that we've sought information from our members, so it's not an area that I'd be confident in giving you a response on those particular funding streams. There might be others on the call who are better able to say what that impact would be.
Okay, thanks, Peter.
To earlier on, so it might
I was just about to go to Joe.
I think what our concern is that at the moment you remove dedicated funding, you then open up the opportunity for 32 different versions of what is essentially already proven to be a very effective programme of supporting somebody who is in a distressed situation. So that our concern is, how do you retain the effectiveness of that programme that has been piloted over the last period when you do a national rollout, and removing the dedicated funding suggests that it might then be open to interpretation. We've seen it happen on other programmes like Individual Placement and Support, which is an employability programme, which supports people with severe and enduring mental health problems into sustained work. It is the single most effective programme to do that, and it's been proven time and time again to be so. But the minute it gets into the procurement system, it becomes a light version of itself, and therefore you lose the fidelity of the programme.
Thank you. And Paula Fraser, do you have a comment on that? I think you're on mute.
Sorry, I don't know if I know particularly about the impact that the reduced funding has had. I just know from what members have reported that it has become more difficult for them to access services, and even those who would maybe have depended on phoning NHS 24, for example, during the night if they can't access other crisis services, have reported maybe not being able to actually get through to somebody or not really getting the help that they need when they need to. But I don't know whether that's a direct impact of reduced funding or and in terms of distress brief intervention for most of our members because of what enduring severe and enduring mental health conditions they have, that wouldn't necessarily be an appropriate way to go, but I can totally understand that it's really helpful for other people, and I can see what Joe's saying about the keeping it consistent if it's not dedicated funding.
Finally, I'll ask Shari McDade whether she's got any views on this.
So, sorry, just I wanted to just add one more piece about online mental health, digital mental health, which is that the evidence around its effectiveness is that it's better when it's guided by a professional. So it's important to bear that in mind, that there's maybe some views that it's possible to replace clinical support or the support of a mental health professional with digital, but actually what is proven to be effective is where there is a therapist involved. It might enable the therapist to see more people than if there was all face-to-face, but having a therapist involved in the online is really the best approach.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. And I think, Joe, you mentioned earlier on the Aberdeen example has been something that's under threat because of funding issues. And if you or any of the other panellists have got other examples of that kind of initiative which might be at risk, if you could give us a note in writing, that would be really, really helpful. Because I'm going to have to move it on and invite Willie Coffey to put some questions.
Thanks very much, convener. And hello, everybody. I wonder if I could take us back to talking a little bit about how we reduce mental health inequalities. There's been some discussion earlier on. The Auditor General's paper that I'm sure you've read points to certain groups within society, and inequalities basically reflect the inequalities in society that we're seeing. I suppose that's obvious. I mean, people that are living under deprivation circumstances, issues that affect young people, LGBT people, people with learning disabilities, and we're hearing today, of course, it affects ethnic minorities. So my question is that the funding that's been allocated to the Mental Health Directorate over recent years has gone up significantly. From in 2020, it was £130 million a year. Now it's nearly £300 million a year. So where's this money going? Is it not being spent and targeted correctly and appropriately, in your opinion? And what more do we need to do that? I wonder if I could just start with Dr. McDade, but I'd really appreciate, convener, if we could hear a short, brief kind of perspective on this from each of our panellists, if that's possible.
Sure, and I'll be as brief as I can. When you're talking about trying to reduce mental health inequalities, and this is something that the foundation is very feels is a very big priority, the reality is that many of the reasons why there are mental health inequalities lie outside the mental health services. And therefore, until we really have a whole of government, whole society approach to addressing mental health, we will see those inequalities persist. And one of the concerns that we have in the foundation is that the Mental Health Strategy Delivery Plan, which was just published, is still relatively vague on how
government departments beyond the Mental Health Directorate, beyond the NHS Mental Health Services, will be involved in taking action on mental health. So we think that one of the best ways to reduce mental health inequalities is to require that every government decision is assessed for its impact on mental health. And that would mean that decisions around Social Security, around transport, around housing, around investment in community spaces and in government, that those decisions would be assessed for their mental health impact. And I think that if that was taking place, and we would find that the circumstances within which people are trying to have good mental health would change and be more balanced, so that individuals who are at higher risk would have a better chance.
Thanks very much for that. Joe, could you offer a perspective on that? The money, the funding has been increasing. Are we targeting correctly, properly, and so on?
I would wholeheartedly agree with everything that Shari just said about the cross-government opportunity. The delivery plan itself that was published earlier this week is vague on that. And there are, I think, something like 80-something national policies that are listed at the back of that delivery plan, but no sense of how we're going to make that a reality. So we would urge that great attention is paid to how we implement that over the course of the delivery plan. And in terms of funds, I noticed in the in your question, you were talking about the Community's Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund as a particular example of a recent kind of innovation regarding Mental Health Directorate spending. And as much as it's welcome, it's on an annual basis, so it's limited in terms of its effectiveness in that regard. But we also know very little about, in fact, we know nothing about the outcomes for those individuals who have been the recipients of something through. Now, I'm not saying that there wasn't some benefit to those individuals, but we don't know. So we know how many people might have received support in some way, but we don't know the outcomes for them. And that's the kind of data, transparent data, that we need going forward in terms of being able to assess mental health spending.
My colleague Graham Simpson is going to touch on outcomes in a wee while, I think. But I wonder if I could just ask Miriam, something you said earlier, Miriam, you said there isn't even multilingual information in a number of circumstances for people from minority ethnic communities to use to help them to direct towards these services. Is that actually the case? I mean, I'm astounded at that, convener, if we don't even provide information that people need to give them a pathway to getting some support services here. So could you tell us just a little bit more about that, please?
As I said, from our experience working with ethnic minorities women, so we found out that they don't have this information. They don't have information. So the only way they know is to contact the GP, to refer them. So there was no bill language services provided for them. So because of that, we tried to provide service that helped them, like counselor who speaks both languages, Arabic and English. And we found a high demand for this service. Although, as I said, when we started, we had only 2 hours a week to provide a service. And now we were able to secure this service for 6 hours a week, as they found out that they prefer to speak to the same person and who speaks both languages. And we, unfortunately, we were able to provide this service to English speakers and Arabic speakers only. We weren't able to find or we were able to have all that fund to find counselors who speaks more languages, actually. And also there is a challenge we are facing that we don't have more fund to continue this project. We have only 2 years because we were funded by the Big Lottery Community Fund mental health project, and now they are not providing this kind of project anymore. So we don't know what's going to happen in the next. So this is where we were able to provide only like Arabic and English counselors. So hopefully in the future, if the NHS can provide this kind of, or get more support to community groups to provide this kind of services.
Thanks very much for that, Miriam. That's something I think the committee will be keen to follow up on. I wonder, Kirsten, if you're still there. I know you have to leave about 10:30, but could you give us a little perspective on these issues and why these inequalities are exist, particularly for young people? We've seen this in the report, that young people often report much higher levels of anxiety, stress and mental health-related issues. And you've described a few circumstances here, but could you just give us a little flavour of what we need to do more to effectively target spend in the areas that we need to reduce the inequalities that we're all talking about today?
I think it's, you know, absolutely, I appreciate spend has gone up around mental health. I think that it's such an all-encompassing issue that it could be a challenge to think about where that funding is diverted to at the moment. And I think is what we've also got to take into consideration is the intersectionality of so many of these things that we've identified. And I think that then is a challenge in itself in terms of how you're providing that effective support to all people, but particularly to kind of young people. I fully agree with Dr. McDade's kind of view on that kind of whole system approach to a person, to a young person, because actually quite often, you know, mental health, you know, kind of poor mental health is a result of circumstances of a young person's kind of living situation, their relationships, their life, their kind of experiences. And I think that, like I mentioned before, I feel that a lot of focus is rightly so on the kind of, I suppose, the kind of fixing the problem, maybe the kind of sticking plaster, but what are we doing kind of further upstream in terms of early and effective intervention for people, for young people in particular? I think the world that we live in at the moment can feel like a quite heavy place for everybody, but particularly for young people. They've had their education disrupted during COVID. Key milestones in their lives were missed for a lot of young people, and that social interaction and the things that make people people. I think that quite often when young people talk about getting support face-to-face, it's maybe not physically face-to-face, but it's that human connection. It's the social isolation and loneliness and all these things that young people are experiencing. You just have to turn on the news at the moment, and it is a very stark reality for lots of young people. But not only that, when you think about something like climate anxiety, quite often we look to young people to come up with the solutions, and they're the ones that are bearing the brunt of thinking that they have to deal with this in the future. So you put all that together, and we're not painting a very optimistic future for young people. The Carnegie report that came out this week about the wellbeing index and the kind of difference in kind of those over 55 and young people in terms of their wellbeing is quite a stark reminder for all of us that our young people are challenged in the current environment. And I think that, yes, there absolutely needs to be resource allocated to you know, kind of mental health provision, but actually it's about what's that whole system approach to young people's lives, about the things that they can access, the opportunities they can take part of, the type of education that they have. So I think it's wider than mental health support services. It's actually about all the infrastructure that sits around a young person, which I think needs that attention. And just on Joe's point as well, the kind of annual funding cycle of some of these things as well is it's huge. I mean, it's coming from a third sector organisation who provides mental health information for young people. The year-to-year kind of cycle of that makes it very challenging for us to do any long-term planning. I think also I would just say, as I always would, it's really important we keep having these conversations with young people, involve them in this, that we're not making decisions on their behalf, that we're young people are at the table when we're talking about what solutions might be kind of moving forwards.
Thanks so much for that, Kirsten. Conveners, are anybody else online wanting to?
Yeah, I think both Simon and Peter indicated they want to come in on this question.
Thanks.
So we'll go to Simon next.
Well, thanks. Yes, there's quite a big Polish community in Edinburgh, so we have quite a lot of Polish members, and it's interesting what they say to us about why they don't access NHS services, because often they will pay to fly to Poland and pay to get treatment in Poland that they could get free in Scotland, but they're not doing that. And I guess we ask, well, why don't you? And there are trust issues with the NHS. They don't, I guess we're all brought up to worship and adore the NHS, and I guess other communities don't necessarily have that ingrained in them, and they don't trust it, and they don't trust where data goes, what the data sharing. They are concerned about health and government sharing information, that there's that issue, but there's quality issues. This is hard to hear, and I think people don't, you know, NHS morale is low and they don't want to hear, but basically the Polish people say that our health service is better than yours. Okay, we have to pay, but what you get, yeah, we wouldn't put up with that. And I appreciate people don't want to hear that, but that's what Polish people say to us. Yeah, so just about what to spend things on, just assuming that more and more NHS is going to bring in BME communities, I'm not sure that's correct.
Thanks, Simon.
Peter.
Thanks. I'll try to be brief. I think I echo much of what Shari has already said. I mean, the answers to how we reduce mental health inequalities largely lie outside of the mental health system. So I think one thing that we do need to do in terms of policy within Scottish Government and other parts of the policy-making framework in Scotland is make sure that there's alignment. So is there alignment between our efforts to reduce child poverty? We have a very well-developed child poverty strategy with regular delivery plans, but are they really as closely aligned to issues around mental health and reducing mental health inequalities? Do they pay good enough? Do they take good enough cognizance of mental health issues? I think there's some way to go there yet. Again, we have priorities around developing a well-being economy. Now, that absolutely has to be fundamental to addressing mental health inequalities. So when we look at the way that our labour market operates, issues around security of contract, around stability of work, around the hours that people have, these all contribute to whether we're effective in reducing mental health inequalities. So I think taking that into account when we're developing our approaches in these areas will help reduce those inequalities. And one further area that I think is really important is around housing. And we know that Edinburgh has just declared a housing emergency. We know the stress, the impact that insecure accommodation has on people. If we're to address mental health inequalities, if we're to address the stress that comes through homelessness, then that's one area that we need to prioritise, I think.
Thanks very much for that, Peter. I think I'll hand over.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you.
And in the time remaining, I'm going to invite Graeme Simpson to lead us through a discussion on an area that the committee is keen to get your views on. Can I also say, though, that we would very much welcome any written submissions that you want to make to the committee. If you feel as though we haven't covered some of the ground that you wanted to, we've really been up against the clock this morning, and there's been a lot of rich evidence presented to us, which we will certainly be keen to look at in more detail and reach some conclusions about. But if you have anything that we haven't got to that you could submit to us in writing, we would really appreciate that. But finally, to hand over to Graeme. Graeme.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I just want to come back on something that Kirsten said while you're still with us, Kirsten. I know you've got to shoot off. But you said that the world feels like a heavy place for everyone, and there's a danger, do you not think, of giving the impression that we've got a nation of stressed out young people who are struggling with life. And, well, that's not the case for every young person, is it? I mean, there are some young people who struggle, but not everyone's in that place. We don't want to give that impression, do we?
No, absolutely not. And apologies if that's how it came across. It's absolutely not my intention to do that. I think there's, you know, as an organisation that supports young people to do amazing things and to participate, and they're sharing their voices and views. And we've actually got a generation of young people who are very kind of socially aware and socially active and are very kind and considerate and caring about others. And we have a brilliant kind of generation of young people in Scotland. I think you know, the opportunities, but I think we have to pay attention to that, don't we? We have to, you know, whilst it's not true of everybody, it is true of some young people, and they are being exposed to a wide range of a very changing environment, you know, a changing environment kind of, you know, that they are living in. And I think that we can only see it as a positive that young people are motivated to seek support for their mental health and emotional well-being. They are thinking about the types of services that they can access, but we absolutely have a fantastic generation of young people, lots of good opportunities, lots of prospects. They are active in shaping that. I mean, everything that I've talked about today has come from young people telling us kind of what their views are and how they would like to see things change and be better for them and future generations. So I absolutely agree with you. I'm all about positivity and opportunities for young people, but I think it's also for those that need that support. We should have an adequate system that does support them. So yes, and apologies if I gave a bit of a doom and gloom view of the world of young people.
Well, I'm glad you've injected some positivity there, and I'll let you go because I know you've got to shoot off. But thanks for that. Really appreciate that. I think I'm just going to ask Joe about this because I know we're up against the clock. And Joe, you mentioned earlier about outcomes, and the report does state that the Scottish Government doesn't measure the quality of services or outcomes for people who receive mental health care, which seems to me to be a huge oversight. So I just wonder if you have any views on, you know, if you're accepting that should be rectified, how should it be rectified, and what kind of things should we be measuring?
I mean, I think that, and we've been saying this for a long time, along with many others who were on the screen, that it is crucial for us to understand the effective use of the mental health budget. We need to know what works for people, and it can be done because it's being done in England right now. So there is, it used to be called IAPT. And it's now called NHS England's Talking Therapies for Anxiety and Depression Programme. And we've studied this and written quite a lot about it. There is routinely published individual outcomes data that's readily available. It includes data on recovery and lots of other things as well. And so it is a good example of what can be done. I'm not saying it's the only example, but it just demonstrates that it's possible. And the fact that we can only measure things by waiting time targets on a quarterly basis is just not good enough. And we absolutely must get to a position where we understand the effectiveness of an intervention on an individual. We do it in our organisations because we have other, funders who expect it of us. So it can be done.
Yeah, I mean, there are examples in Scotland, even, of various organisations doing their own thing.
Yeah.
But as you say, we haven't got that sort of nationwide.
National standard.
I'm actually seeing somebody else nodding. Who's that? Paula Fraser, I think. No, you weren't nodding. You were nodding. You are nodding.
I was nodding. So just in agreement, yes, that I mean it does seem ridiculous that we don't collect that information, that data, and have that evidence about how things are working and where they're working for people. And that would be very welcome if we were able to do that.
So I think if I can go back to Joe, I mean, you mentioned this model in NHS England. Why do you think we're not doing something similar? I mean, does NHS Scotland, why are they not doing it? Has anyone asked them to?
I don't know.
No.
I mean, Sam H has written a number of times in response to consultations and submissions about it is a good example and it's worth looking at. I know that people from the IAP programme have been in Scotland talking on this. Right. So I think it's entirely possible.
That's possibly a question for government. I know we'll have the government in at some point. I've got a separate question, and it's a question that arises in the report. and it's down to the spending on medicines. This isn't necessarily a question for you, Joe. I'm just looking at you because you're in the room, but it could be for anyone. So the spending on medicines to deal with mental health, and the spending has gone down. Well, that's because the cost of drugs has gone down, but actually the number of items being dispensed has gone up. So I just wonder whether anyone has a view on whether that is appropriate, that we are prescribing more and more drugs. Are there better ways of dealing with mental health? Is it too easy to prescribe drugs? And I do see someone nodding, and I think that is Simon. So you may want to come in on that, Simon.
I'm just reprising yes, we are. There definitely is too much emphasis on medication and an unchallenged assumption that just keep taking the tablets works, that it's as simple as that. You know, either get professional help or just keep taking the tablets. And that is an old, that these are very old fashioned ideas, but we still hold to them. So about the lack of evidence, it is very interesting that such an evidence led discipline, you know, medicine, it's all meant to be evidence led. Why can't they provide the evidence for this? And I suppose one possibility is because they know the evidence would not support that it is effective. I remember Colin Mackay from the Mental Welfare Commission saying there is no evidence that hospital inpatient treatment, detention, coercion, there's no actual evidence that it works. We do it. Everyone assumes we must do it. That's the answer for mental health at the severe end. But it is an interesting question. And yeah, why can't they provide evidence that it is efficacious?
Yeah, Simon. I mean, if you're going to do something, whatever it is you're doing, you need to know that it's working and why it works or why it doesn't work. You're the voice. You're billed here as the voice of experience. So, yeah. Tell us your experience.
Well, they would say that coercion, detention are necessary evils. But I think the people I represent just say it's evil. It isn't necessary. If this is a civilized society, and I think Scotland is, we can come up with better solutions. That a lot of the mental health system is backed up by this element of coercion that we would argue, patients argue, that's what creates the stigma. If you lock somebody up for something, that tends to mean it gets stigmatised. So the solution is take the coercive element out, and that is what UNCRPD would say you should do. So I think our one, in terms of data that you could be monitoring, the Scott Review recommended that we will at least try and work to the reduction of coercion. So could you put in costed things? Yeah, you don't get your money unless you are actually reducing coercion, because I think what history teaches us, what tends to happen with every new Mental Health Act is that it ratchets up, the use of coercion ratchets up year after year, detentions go up year after year. They all start with the let's be least restrictive, and they all end up with let's keep locking people up and institutionalising them. So could you create a mechanism whereas, you get money if you reduce coercion, but if it just keeps going up, sorry, but we're not going to pay for that anymore.
Thanks, Simon. This coercion, it's obviously a big deal for you. You've mentioned it quite a few times. Does anyone else want to come in? I'm going to look at a screen with lots of faces on. And
Paula and Dr. McDade are interested in coming in.
Right. Paula, you were mentioned first.
Yes, so I can totally understand a lot of what Simon's saying, and we do hear that from members of ours. And obviously we're really keen to see that there is a reduction in coercion that's been recommended by the Scott Review. In terms of medication, we've got a really varying kind of wealth of experience in our members, where many members will really talk about how much the medication that they're on has really helped them alongside for example, having community psychiatric nurse appointments that are regular with somebody that they trust. And I think that's quite important. A lot of it is because the medication is working alongside something else that is helping them as well. But of course, we've had lots of very bad experiences where people feel that all they've been offered is medication or a higher dose of a medication, particularly with things like depression, and nothing else alongside it that is actually helping them, and that's all that's being offered. So I mean, I don't know. And obviously, I know a lot of the increase in medication, you hear reports around the increase in antidepressants being prescribed. I would have assumed that's to do with the lack of resource or workforce to be able to give other therapies and other treatments or help, and that medication's the kind of resort that the GP has to go to because there's not that other help. But yeah, there's a kind of balance of there's really, really important for some of our members that they have access to the medication that really helps keep them well, but you really need that other support, and how important it is to in terms of money and where the money's spent. From what we hear, a lot of money is spent on locum psychiatrists, for example. A lot of money that could otherwise be spent a lot more wisely. And I hope that the workforce plan is going to do something to help with that, so that you actually can recruit and retain staff who are psychiatrists or CPNs within the areas that they're needed, rather than using locums, and that money that's left then can actually be used elsewhere to help. For example, what I mentioned earlier in terms of community resources, community wellbeing hubs and things like that help to keep people well.
Okay. And Dr. McDade?
So I really was requesting to speak in relation to your question about young people and whether we were overstating the extent of the distress there. And if I can use this opportunity to comment on that, if you don't mind. When we did our Thriving Learners studies, and we did two studies, one study was of 17,000 university students in Scotland, and one study was of 2,000 students in colleges in Scotland. In colleges, we found two-thirds of college students had low mental well-being, and over half reported symptoms of moderate to severe depression. Two-thirds with low mental well-being and over half with moderate to severe depression. And when we gathered that information for college students, nearly three-quarters reported low well-being, and about a third reported moderate to severe or severe symptoms of depression. So I do think we need to squarely
Can I come in there, Dr. McDade?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
What question were you asking them? Because if you phrase a question, do you get stressed about things? Most people say yes. It depends what you ask. So what question were you asking?
So I can get you the detail of the questions, but I can say that the questions we were asking were quite standard questions for how to measure well-being and how to measure symptoms of depression. So we weren't just asking students whether they feel stressed. We were using standardized questions that are considered reliable for gathering that information. So I think we have to acknowledge that there are levels of distress in the young people of Scotland. What I think is so impressive, maybe, is the levels of resilience. You know that we don't see every or three quarters of college students seeking mental health support. So clearly, some are managing to cope without seeking mental health support. But I think it behooves us to recognize the extent of the difficulty, and that's the best way that we can move forward in terms of responding, and particularly for young people for whom they have their whole life ahead of them. And so if we respond early at this point
in their lives, there's a much better chance of better outcomes in the remainder of their life.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I think I got a note to say that Peter Kelly wanted to come in one final time. So we've just got a couple of minutes left, Peter, if you want to come in. I think it was probably on some of the broader issues that were raised in that last section. But over to you, Peter.
It was. Thank you. It was really just to come back on the question of increasing medication. I'm not going to comment on that specifically, but I think what's very clear from the grassroots community organisations that responded to our call for evidence was that social isolation is one of the big factors that drives problems in mental health and stigma associated with the experience of poverty and with the experience of mental health, also one of the key drivers. And I think where community-based responses are in a very good position to support people with that relatively low level of mental distress. We've seen, for example, members of ours, the SPFL Trust, working with the community grassroots community football clubs and trusts associated with football clubs. They've been a real driving force in tackling social isolation, often particularly for men, but not only for men. And addressing mental ill health through that means. So I think, just very finally, if we're to think about alternatives, we need to support our community and voluntary sector more effectively. And questions around funding have been raised again and again in this session about the duration of funding, the stability of funding. And I just repeat that need for that longer, more sustained funding for third sector organisations.
Peter, on that very clear note, can I thank you very much? And can I thank all of our witnesses this morning? It's been a very fruitful session. And as I said earlier on, I think the evidence that we've taken has been very rich in quality from all of you. So can I thank Kirsten, who's no longer here, but also Simon, Shari, Peter, Paula and Miriam, who joined us online. Thank you very much for your contributions this morning. And to Joe, who joined us in the committee room, thank you very much indeed as well for the evidence that you've given us. We've got future sessions where we'll speak to some of those agencies and organisations that are on the front line providing the services, and then we will also speak to those who've got some responsibility for the oversight of the implementation and delivery of these services before we expect to have a session with the accountable officer in the Scottish Government about the state of adult mental health services. So thank you very much indeed for helping to inform our work and hopefully getting some important messages out to a wider audience as well. So thank you very much indeed, and I'm now going to draw the public part of this morning's session of the committee to a close.